Anyone here had read at least one of Harry Potter books? Raise your hand. Who read all of them? Who had read one of them at least 5 times? 10 times? This question was asked by me first time 8 years ago when I gave a seminar for 30 principals of schools in Israel. We used to meet once a month for 4 or 3 hours and discuss different aspects of leadership. On the third meeting, when they were used to me, it was in an average high school, I filled all of the tables with Harry Potter books. When they came inside, I raised one of the books and asked them, who had read all of Harry Potter books? Neither of them raised their hands. Who read some of the Harry Potter books? Again, no comment. When I asked if anyone had read at least one of the Harry Potter books, 3 of them raised their hands. One of them, she raised her hand into the middle, meant I was planning to read, I still didn't find the time. I said, thank you very much. Raise up, and we went into the first classroom. There were 17-year-old kids on the 11th grade. I was holding the third book of Harry Potter. I introduced the principals to the kids and I asked, who had read at least one of Harry Potter books? 75% of the kids raised their hands. Then I asked, who had read all of them? 50%. Then I asked, who read 3 times, 7 times, 12 times? When I continued going on, the principals had figured that there are some kids that are always in the middle of one of Harry Potter books. Then I start asking about spells, about people, about actions. And very quick, the principals understood that if there was a final exam about Harry Potter, these kids would succeed in Harry Potter better than any subject that they think that is more important than anything. I said, thank you very much to the kids. And we went back into our seminar class. And then I told the principals, today the subject is the secret about Harry Potter. What had made Harry Potter an outstanding book that not only made J.K. Rowling one of the 10 most wealthy women in the world, some say even more wealthy than the Queen of England, but what's the secret of Harry Potter that for 10 years, hundreds of millions of youngsters and young adults were reading Harry Potter more than the Bible, that it was printed more than the Bible, and some people say the Bible is a very important book. It was translated to more than 1,000 languages when Harry Potter was translated about 70 languages. What's the secret? Is it about a new version of fantasy? We know that fantasy books, they start, if we go backward 300 years, to one of the most important fantasy books. George Orwell says, The Gulliver Travels. I can imagine everyone here had read at least once Gulliver Travels. So I'd let these principals to give ideas. After half an hour, when I didn't get the answer I was looking for, I said, I'll try giving you my assumption why Harry Potter became the most important book in the last 100 years and the most printed book in the last 100 years. And the first thing is what Rowling repeats in every book and hints almost in every chapter is that Harry Potter is an orphan child, that he is an orphan from a mother and father. Both of them are dead. I claim that what struck hundreds of millions of young adults and youngsters is that they felt in our generation, on the 20th and the 21st century, that they are orphaned from real adults, real parents, that know how to demand from them. The second thing was the Hogwarts school, where you have Dumbledore and the unique mentors. It's a school that every child can get to it. Boys and girls, black and white, redhead and darkhead, nice ones and gentle, some evil, mean, some rude, some very quiet, but everyone, even if you come from a prominent family or a very poor family, is welcomed in this school. But this school is about something else. It's about demanding of greatness. Be somebody in life. Be someone. Take life seriously. Be able to challenge. Even the way to Hogwarts is a quite challenging thing. It's not a school that the only thing that matters is send the kids safely back home. The main game in that school, Quidditch, where they have to fly on broomsticks and endanger their lives, get injured. Because this school is about something else. Be somebody. Be able to challenge. It's your story now. The third thing is the adopting family, his orphan parents, the Dursleys, Uncle Vernon, Aunt Petunia, his cousin Dudley, who are the symbol of whom? The Muggles. The people that lack magic, the people that are all day in front of the news, looking at the internet, reading the yesterday newspaper, and it immediately affects their mood, the way they feel. These are people that it's so easy to raise their memory, even when great things happen around them. Owls in the sky, people dressed with funny clothing. They won't feel a thing because they are always trying to satisfy everyone. They are so frightened from any challenge in their life. What I told the principals of these schools, and my claim was that Harry Potter was the biggest rebellion on the 2021 century. It was the silent rebellion of hundreds of millions of young adults and youngsters screaming to the adults, take us seriously, prepare us for the challenge, open your eyes. Something is happening in the Western civilization. Something is happening in the democracies' countries. And they simply didn't listen. They didn't feel that what's going on, like when in the 80s, and in the perestroika, when the Western civilization became so wealthy, we became so spoiled and self-concerned. And instead of challenging the next step, we were confused. And then, even when there were big signs, like the 11th of September, when the main trade center was attacked and the political center of the empire, or in 2008, when we had the economic crisis, or even now with the immigration. Always we looked for something else or someone else to blame. We didn't dare to say the name or the unsaid name. It was not different in my country, in Israel. We became quite wealthy in the 80s. And then, when you are self-concerned, you always blame others for problems in your state. But what woken us up was in 1995, when our prime minister was assassinated and murdered. It was like an earthquake. It woken up everyone. Because he wasn't murdered by a lunatic. He was murdered in a situation where extreme gap was created between left wing and right wing, between religious and secular. This young state, 67 years today, that was built by solidarity and by a great idea to be an example state, was something was unstable. I was on that time in the army, an officer in special forces. I decided to resign. And within a group of other people, we said, we are going to face the real story. Are we prepared for the future? There is a generation that will take responsibility. And we claim that we have to establish, that was before, to establish academies for leadership in Israel, to recruit the young generation to be able to take responsibility on the future. In order to know how to do it, you always have to go and learn from the experience of others. So we went to England, to Cambridge and Oxford, to see in these colleges on the way they have educated the young generation on the 16th, 17th, 18th, and 19th century to be gentlemen, to be civil servants. We learned how a tutor works with every 7 or 9 students. How do you learn liberal arts? How do you are you built to be a civil servant? And then you understand the progress of the society in England, to be a democracy that can be a place that you can look up to. We came back to Israel and we started, and in 1996 we established the first academy for leadership. Then you will ask me, what's leadership? Leadership is when you face your identity, who you are, the real story of your life, and the identity of every individual is built by yourself, your family, your community, the professionality you take on yourself and you want by your ability to change the world, and your nationality that you are proud on and you are committed to. And on that year, we went to the youngsters or young adults and said, postpone the time you go to army or to civil servant, because in Israel, before you start your life, before you go to university, you have to do things for the state and learn. Learn from 6 o'clock in the morning till 12 o'clock at night. Work on yourself, work on your identity, on your purpose, on your ability to face crisis, to be self-example for others. And we always start with what? With yourself, on working on your body, on your soul, and on your mind. Work on your body from being able, boys and girls, to run half a marathon, to be able to fight martial arts, because you will resist any evil. You can have a great body, an excellent mind because of liberal arts, because of studying great books, because of having mentors that will be with you day and night. But it doesn't mean that you will be a good person. Only if you work on your soul, to have a brave, solid, gentle soul that will be fear nothing, then you can take all of your energy. Then you work on the other spheres of life, hiking in your country, meeting people, and developing the most difficult profession in life, loving other people, different people than you are, to learn your history. Other things you do in the Academy for Leadership, you volunteer and you create projects. Because it's very easy to talk. It's very easy to write articles, but to do, to be self-example, to create institutes that change a society. Afterwards, every academy is a kind of a small state. Before you go and change your society, build your own year and be excellent with values, with abilities. It's a success in Israel. Now we have almost 60 institutes. Last year, 20,000 applications on 3,500 places. And it's growing. And hopefully one day, anyone that wants to be part of this leading movement will be part of it. I could speak hours about our alumni, but I'll give only 3 examples. Yuri Zitterbaum was studying economics in Be'er Sheva University when 7 years ago, the earthquake in Haiti vanishes 1/3 of the state. 3 days after, he's already there. When he sees the thousands of lost kids that survived, he calls his friends and recruits another 20. And for 3 months, they start creating schools for these lost kids. After 3 months that he stopped his life, he went back to university. A month later, he hears that the challenges are bigger. He leaves university, and for 1.5 years, he lives in Haiti. Now he is in Nepal with his friends. Because when you are a leader, you never stand aside. You are part of. Or if we will speak about Yara Firon, Israel sometimes is under missile attacks and terror attacks from Hamas and Hezbollah. We know how to deal with terror. We know how to give the best healthcare. But there are thousands of people on the border that they are alone on these times. So Yara Firon recruited 20,000 volunteers. And every time everyone goes into the shelter, she and the 20,000 volunteers are there to be with the people. Or if I would speak about Ravid and Yehuda, they were in top special forces. They train bodyguards around the world and take different people on extreme hiking around the world, and they are paid quite well, thousands of dollars every week. You would think they will be very wealthy and rich. Every cent they earn, they invest on lost kids and disabled kids to bring them the bravery of life. That's in Israel a change. We have more challenges, but there is a generation that will take responsibility. But in Europe, did Europe wake up to say we have to face our identity? There was only one nation in Europe, one nation that woke up and took responsibility and didn't blame others, simply looked at the mirror. And you know who is this nation? It's you. It's the Ukrainian nation. You were the only ones to face tyranny, to face corruption, to stand day and night in freezing cold, not to fear snipers, and to look at the mirror, not to blame even when you were attacked brutally from the east and thousands of soldiers were killed. You said, we have to create a change in our nation. We have to stand for our identity and be better. And that's what struck us, Israelis, when a group of unbelievable people here said, we are going to go around the world to learn how to do it, how to create a generation that will take responsibility. And when they came to us and saw the academies for leadership, we said, we are going to come and be with you. And last year, on this year, we established the first academy for leadership here in Kyiv. We went to the best schools in Ukraine, and we recruited. And when I say we, I had the privilege to be part of Roman, of Lena, of Natalia, of Yaroslava, these great people, these magic people that stopped their life and said, we have to wake up. We don't need to wait for others. And hundreds of young adults here in Ukraine said, our university will wait. There is something more important. We will work on ourselves. And better than the Israelis. When they came to Israel, they said, in every standard they are working in Israel, we are going to learn harder, to volunteer harder, to be better. And now there is a dream and a vision that next year in Lviv, in Kharkiv, in Dnipropetrovsk, in Odessa, we will have academies for leadership. And around each academy for leadership, to have at least 10 to 15 groups of national service leadership, and to have hundreds of young adults that they stop their life and take responsibility. And just imagine the year 2020 when you will have in each region in Kyiv an academy for leadership, and you will have 10,000 young adults that will say, we don't blame no one. We respect the past. We know what we passed. But we are going to create a future. We are going to create an example society. We have a dream that what happens here in Ukraine will waken up all Europe, all of the Western civilization, to start working on their identity, to take responsibility to the future, that there will be thousands of young adults that instead of jumping to university in England and in Vienna and in Netherlands and in Holland and in Denmark and in France, that they won't be afraid to say the unsaid name. They'll say it's a generation that has a lack of identity. There are good reasons, but we are going to take responsibility for the next 50 years. But we had adults, we have to encourage them. We have to encourage them how? Leadership is not about an academy for leadership. Leadership is about everyone that sits now here. Leadership is taking your life seriously. Understanding that a group of 5-10 people can change history. It's to understand that in every week there are 168 hours. Let's start of working on our body, minimum 4 hours of training, of strength. Minimum 4 hours a week or a week of reading great books and great ideas and working on our heart, seeing our neighbors, saying good morning, and you will say, what, I know you from somewhere? No, simply I'm your neighbor. Do you need any help? To knock a door, anyone that has an employee, to give him a gift for Christmas and not only for Christmas. To understand if he's sick or feels bad. To understand it's not about money. It's about how do we do a society. It's about great ideas. It's if every one of us will walk out today and say, I'm taking responsibility. I feel myself carrying the history of my nation. And one day, my kids, and have many kids, minimum 3 kids each family, will be proud in this place, and all of the world would look up to us. We have to do it. If not, history never lies. But the moments are the ones. It's not about Harry Potter. It's about the team. It's about great women that know how to demand from men, be good, be better, be the best. Good luck.